Good evening and welcome to The Big Fight, a show that is young at 21, the oldest running debate show on Indian News Television. I'm Sanket Upadhyay. We've divided this show today in two parts because we are going to deal with two issues separately. Issue number one, there is a vaccine strategy in India. A lot of hard work, a lot of research, a lot of meetings went into this, into strategizing how we are going to roll out the vaccination process. It began as early as August 2020. But we see that right now, and let's face it and say it very clearly, there is a shortage, there is a problem. And then we see a lot of decisions being taken. For instance, the latest being that the difference between the two jabs of Covishield was first increased from 4 weeks to 6 weeks to 8 weeks. And then now, in a recent decision, it has been increased to 12 to 16 weeks. So are these decisions around the vaccine backed by science or availability or both? There are many questions around India's vaccine strategy, which we are going to discuss in our first segment in just a short moment with two experts who are going to join us. But story number two, the debate number two, there are people who are helping people out, but they have been questioned today across party lines, not just the Congress, even people from the BJP. The police says that we are only doing our job because the court has asked us to do this. The court never asked any such thing. The court only listed out a procedure that the petitioners may go or appear before the police and they may investigate. So is this a process of investigating and inquiring all those people who are helping, or is this witch hunt, as is now being alleged by the Congress as well as the Aam Aadmi Party? We'll put that to debate in just a short moment from now. But our discussion number one on India's vaccine strategy, I would like to introduce two very special guests, Dr. N.K. Arora, Chairman of the COVID Working Group, member of the NTAGI, the National Technical Advisory Group on Immunization. Thank you very much, Dr. Arora. It's a pleasure to have you on the show. And we also have Dr. Randeep Guleria, Director of the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. Thank you very much, Dr. Guleria. I want to come to you, Dr. Arora, and ask a question which is on everyone's mind right now. Should vaccination have been opened for all at a time like this? Because it's very clear there is a shortage.
So, in a simple way, the prioritization for giving vaccine was done in September, October last year. And it was very clear, as per the availability of the vaccine, that the immediate purpose of vaccination will be to reduce morbidity and mortality. And obviously the highest risk population is to be targeted. And that is why 45 years plus population plus frontline workers were the, even today there is sufficient vaccine to take care of them till July end. About 50-55 crore doses will be available for them. But getting and expanding the age group for 18 to 45, clearly, there is no vaccine available, there is shortage, and I would say that it should have been deferred a while for this population because we don't have the vaccine.
Oh, you feel that it should have been deferred?
Important thing is that vaccine is not available within the country. Equally important is that globally also, vaccine is not available. Hmm. Many of us feel that tender de dega, to usse vaccine idhar se udhar se aa jayega. But that is not correct. There is hardly any vaccine doses available globally because these are committed manufacturing which has been taken care or cornered by some of the high income countries.
Correct.
So hardly available any vaccine for in the open market.
Correct. I think you're mentioning a very important point, Dr. You're saying that the age group of 18 to 45 should not have been opened just yet. It should have been deferred. And yet, here we are where this has happened. Can I know from you that, was the government advised? What was your opinion? What was the generic opinion among decision makers?
So, in fact, I have already said very clearly that our group had prioritized 45 years, 50 years actually, 50 years plus the frontline workers. And that has been, and we know that sufficient vaccine was organized, arranged for this particular group so that they are covered by July or maximum mid-August.
Okay. Dr. Guleria is also with us. Dr. Guleria, you know, in a statement in March, the government said, and I quote, that the gap between two doses of Covishield should not exceed 8 weeks. Should not exceed eight weeks. And now here we are where this gap has been increased to 12 to 16. Now, I want to ask you whether this is a decision out of availability concerns or scientific consideration, or actually both.
So I think this is a decision out of both, honestly speaking. Firstly, if you look at the data which has come out more recently, not only the article in The Lancet, but from other countries also, it clearly shows two or three things. The first thing that we want to know is that if we were to delay the second dose, are those who get just one dose sufficiently protected till the time that we delay it? Secondly, is there any decrease in the immunity if we give the booster dose after 12 weeks? Both the studies which have come out over the last few weeks or months suggest that with one dose, you get an immunity which is from getting disease, which is more than 70%. Therefore, one dose is also effective in preventing getting significant disease in terms of hospitalization, in terms of ICU care. Also, the data suggests that if you were to delay, if you were to give the shot, the gap between the two shots, the prime and the booster, was less than 4 weeks, your immunity was only around 55 to 60%. But if you were to delay it to 12 weeks, your immunity, the neutralizing antibodies would go up to almost 80 to 90%. Based on that, and like you said, looking at logistic issues in terms of doses available, this strategy was, I think, adopted. And this is a strategy which is not new. This is something that UK did when they had this huge surge in the number of cases in December, November, December, due to the UK variant. They did. They took this strategy. They adopted a strategy without that much of science. They did it as a public health measure. But now there is science to support it, and even the WHO recommends that this should be done. But in the previous meeting, it was really felt that we should be looking at it more critically, get more data in, and I think that's what the group in Tagi did, that they wanted more data, and once they got that, they were confident that we could delay it to 12 to 16 weeks. At the same time, like I said, from the public health point of view, considering the number of doses we have, it is also something that makes more practical sense.
Yeah, that will cover a greater number of people who will get the first jab. I get your point, Dr. Guleria, but you know, there is also a valid concern which a lot of people have raised. They say, what happens to all those who have, according to an earlier policy, got the two jabs only with a 4 week duration or a 6 week duration? So is the government now trying to say that, you know, you're less protected, and now the ones, you know, people from here on will be more protected?
So I get your point. The point is that, you see, science is an evolving thing. COVID-19, the data evolves with time. We started off 1 year ago with really strongly promoting hydroxychloroquine. Not only we, the United States promoted a lot, but we learned that it's not worthwhile, and we came out with other drugs. We were reluctant to use steroids. Now we feel steroids in moderate to severe illness makes a big difference. So this will be an evolving process. How many doses of the vaccine do we need subsequently? Do we need to give another jab after 6 months or 1 year? Will depend upon the data which emerges.
Sure.
So COVID-19, the science is evolving, and I don't think we can say that what I'm saying today will be sort of written in stone and cannot be changed a few weeks or months later, because that is going to happen.
And to be fair, even in that press statement in March, it started by saying, as per the scientific data available now. I mean, this rider was there in quite clearly for everyone to read. Dr. Arora, I want to come back to you. Now, the government has released data saying that, and it's a projection of their augmented supply of the vaccine, where they've given this really, what should I say, optimistic number of 216 crore doses. I mean, this will fill everyone up with positivity that, you know, the vaccine is coming. It's right there by August to December. My question to you is, Dr. Arora, how will we manage, where's the capacity to produce, store, and more importantly, who is going to pay for this? Do we have all those things in place?
So a little bit of what Dr. Guleria has said, that we made a decision of 4 weeks in January, very well knowing what is unpublished data available at that time. And so it was a considerate decision and opinion for 4 weeks at that time. At 8 weeks, again, we reviewed the data and we thought that we should not expose, because breakthrough infections can occur if the interval between two doses is very wide. And now we are seeing, we got the data in the last week of April, which showed that it is giving 65 to 80, 85% protection before the second dose is given. And this is from on the ground, and that gave the confidence to the committee that yes, the time is there, because it will help the community. The question that those who have already received at 4 weeks or 12 weeks, again, they have much higher antibodies than just single dose. Mm. So they are very well protected, and it should not, because one study from USA shows that if two doses are given at 4 week interval, the protection occurs in 79%. So this whole AstraZeneca issue is not so clean, and the largest user are only two in this country, in this globe. One is UK, the other is India. And so data exchange between two of us is important. And I must tell you that Government of India, the committee has recommended that we immediately establish a vaccine tracking mechanism platform, so that if breakthrough infections increase or decrease, if there is any of these in 3 months' time, we need to revisit that. Mm. So there is, as Dr. Guleria very rightly said, it's an evolving science, and the scientific evidence is very important for making a decision for a country of our size. Mm. Now, coming to your second question of the production capacity and vaccine. So all of, we know that our two major producers, one is Covaxin, the other is Covishield. Covishield is currently manufacturing 7 crore doses, and it is going to be increased to 10 to 12 by August. Mm-hmm. Similarly, Covaxin is manufacturing just 1.5 crores, and this capacity is going to be enhanced to about 12 crores by August. Mm-hmm. And three other companies are coming up to increase the to supplement this production capacity. Third thing is that we have Sputnik, which is to be manufactured by 6 companies. 3 companies have already started manufacturing. They will be manufacturing 6 to 7 million million doses per month, and that will add up. And this is true. I mean, it's real kind of data. Then third thing is, which is coming, is this Johnson & Johnson. They have started manufacturing. They are going to start the bridging trial very soon, and these vaccines will also. So what basically we are saying is that anywhere between 25 to 30 crore doses per month will be available from August, September onwards. Mm. And as a result, our capacity also to deliver these vaccines is about, we can have even, if you remember in April 2nd, 3rd week, we were having 75,000 immunization centers. Each center, even if it has 100 vaccines per day, that makes 7.5 million. And in fact, easily it can give 150 to 200. So we have a huge capacity to deliver the vaccine. And very rapidly we can do that. So
as early as, Dr. Arora, I mean, this is a very welcoming figure. 7.5 million means 75 lakhs. I mean, if we were to scale this up, say for instance, to about a crore a day, is that possible?
Absolutely. That is what I'm trying to say. Hmm. That the vaccine, initially when we were in March end and April first week, we were having around 60,000 immunization centers. So we can very easily give 6 to 6.5 million doses every day. And so now it was increased to 72. And primarily public sector. It is not private sector which is which is providing that support. Only out of 75,000, only 5,000. Even today, if you look at it, it's about 2,500 is private, rest about 35,000-40,000 is government immunization center. Correct. So we have a huge capacity. I will take you back to polio. In polio, in 1 week, we immunize 17 crore children. Now, you may say that you give it through the mouth, but doesn't matter. We reach 17 crore. So the system is very well oiled and is prepared to give that much vaccine to our population. And therefore, delivery is not an issue. As soon as the vaccine becomes available,
availability is the issue.
I think that's the major bottleneck is availability. And it is a global availability. I am part of the COVAX facility at WHO also.
Yeah.
And there is no vaccine. The system has collapsed the day India stopped export. We didn't have any meeting because there is no other vaccine available for distribution. Pfizer committed 40 million doses, but they just provided 1 million and they said, after June, we will think whether we can provide or not.
Correct.
So the issue is that the moment our by July, August, when we have sufficient vaccine, the rapidity with which we can scale up. And here I would say your responsibility as media is to bring community on board. I think a very aggressive community engagement is required so that they come up proactively and accept the vaccine, because we saw that in March and April, the welcome was not as much as we would have expected.
I think now it will be. Now that there is a scarcity, I can tell you that there is no such thing as hesitancy right now. People want the vaccine. And that's the
it
buzz
is not
on the
only acceptability. I think it is that beating we have, as a community, we have received because of the corona. And I think we have lost very precious lives.
Correct.
So I hope what you're saying is true and people should come preactive.
Dr. Guleria, now the other important point here is that even in phase one, which is 60 plus, right, our inoculation figures are not that great. For instance, the latest figures, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, is less than 50%. And the real challenge is rural areas. Even now, that's where the spike is growing now. So, in terms of inoculation, do you feel that this is going to be our very, very important challenge? I mean, we may have centers, but what do you do in those areas?
Correct. And as has just been said, we need to develop a very good communication strategy. Get over the vaccine hesitancy, especially in rural India. Because sometimes you hear that people in rural India feel that this is a disease of larger cities and this is not a disease of villages, and that is why they are not coming forward to get themselves vaccinated. So we have to change the narrative. We have to make people understand the importance of vaccination, have a very aggressive vaccination drive, so that you reach out to those who may not be tech savvy, who may not be able to come to a vaccination center, and are able to then provide them vaccination, especially as far as rural India is concerned. So a special drive or a special mechanism, which is slightly different from what we do in urban India, needs to be developed. Because here people will come for vaccination. They will know how to really go online and book a, let's say, an appointment and come. This may not be possible in many parts of India. And we need to therefore think out of the box, how do we reach out to them?
Correct.
Do we go to each village and set up special camps that we have a sort of a drive there, and people are asked to come forward and get themselves vaccinated? So that strategy also needs to be developed.
Correct.
It has to be done in a very aggressive manner, looking at the, so let's say, the terrain and the issues that each locality or each region in India has.
Okay, Dr. Arora, two things very quickly. Number one, you know, going forward, when we'll have so many vaccines, we've already seen some reports coming in of jabs being mixed, right? Going forward, when we will have so many vaccines, and you know how things are, I mean, you will soon hear more of these stories where there will be some mix-up. How do you stop this? Because this is going to be a big challenge.
Yeah. So, program is already discussing and contemplating on this issue. And it appears that we will have to have regions in the country which are saturated with a particular type of vaccine. All vaccines are more or less having similar efficacy. So, in a certain area, you will
but
get...
But wouldn't that deny people of the choice of the various vaccines? Suppose if I want to make an informed choice of my own vaccine,
so
that's not
there
allowed.
Will be a... The choice will be limited choice. It is not possible because, for example, tomorrow mRNA vaccine comes. and the whole country, 100 crores, everybody wants mRNA vaccine. It's not available. Mm-hmm. So what do you do? So I think this is being thought through very carefully, and we hope that a very practical solution will have to be there. You cannot have a wide variety because programmatically it is also almost impossible that if you have seven vaccines or six vaccines at every city, you have these six, seven types, it will, and it will create the kind of chaos which you are just talking. There is true. Somebody gets COVID first and co-vaccine second, mila usko ya vice versa. Those are issues which have to be avoided, and therefore it will require that there will be a regional kind of a distribution. And I must tell you, most of the vaccines which are coming in future, whether it is DNA vaccine, I forgot to name Cadila Zydus, which is an Indian vaccine.
Correct.
And similarly, mRNA Genova vaccine is coming, which is again Indian vaccine. So all these vaccines, everybody, we should be available, but they provide a reasonable kind of a similar kind of protection.
Okay, and my second question is, a lot of experts have said that this time, if there is a third wave, which is going to be inevitable in the words of Professor K. Vijay Raghavan, then it is going to affect children, right? So, given that, or keeping that in mind, I want to know what is the expert opinion on this? I mean, how vulnerable will children be? Will there be more vulnerable than they already are in the first and the second wave?
No, I do not subscribe to that because the data does not suggest. See, when we had 1 lakh individuals, there is a distribution in various. So in what was there in stage one, phase one of the or wave one of the disease, the proportion of cases in different age groups. And now we have got data from January onward till day before yesterday. And the distribution is exactly similar. So it is not a disproportionate affection of any particular age group. All age groups are there. We are seeing more youth and more children this time because denominator has increased. The total absolute number of individual infected is more, so that we are seeing more severe disease in them. Now, so keeping this in mind, but even it also means that we need to take care of our children. And the welcome point is that Bharat Biotech is starting this trial. We should finish by September or so. So in the fourth quarter of this year, we should have vaccination. And as I see the availability of vaccine, we should be able to vaccinate our young children.
Sure.
But I can tell you one important thing, if we have to take care of the third wave, and that is very meticulous surveillance of genomic, the sequencing of the virus. Because if we find something again as badmash as 617, which has really taken the upsurge, if similar kind of a mutant comes and it is nipped in the bud wherever it is arising, that would be the key strategy to take care of it.
Correct. I think that's a very, very important point. Dr. Guleria, before we go, just want to ask you, don't you think a bigger challenge is going to be with a lot of experts saying that these jabs provide protection only for a few months? About 8-10 months. So by the time we finish our inoculation drive, this is going to be an ongoing process where we'll have to provide booster shots also.
So we will need to see how things evolve. If you're right, if you find that there is waning immunity and chances of reinfection become much more, you may need to have another shot. How quickly you need it, I think we will need more data to say that. And as we are saying that there are different vaccines, so there may be some variation in terms of when you need a booster dose. It's an evolving science, like I said, so it's difficult to say today how when you will need a booster shot. I'm sure by the second half of this year or later, at the end of this year, we'll get better idea in terms of the science behind it and be able to say when should we get the second dose.
Correct. Dr. Guleria, in other words, is saying watch this space because this will be evolving. Dr. Arora, you were smiling. You want to say something?
No, I am smiling because all of you want us to become, besides the scientists or technical people, also astrologers, which is not good.
No. Certainly not. I mean, see, there is a need for authentic information. This is only an effort in that direction.
Sanket, I think we need to understand it is evolving science, evolving understanding, and these gaps in understanding are getting filled up. So in hindsight, we are very, very good. It looks like aisa nahi kiya, ye karna tha. But I think what is being done, it's like a huge public health experiment going on in every aspect, whether it is clinical management, public health, health system management, or vaccine management. It's a big experiment going on. Most of the globe and our country is trying to handle it as well as possible. There would be, I think, as we move forward, there will be good learnings and making it better as the days go.
All right. Dr. Arora, Dr. Guleria, thank you so much for joining us on part one of the Big Fight. Thank you. Let's move on now to discussion number two. And this is a political discussion which happened because of the events of Friday, where the police started probing all those people who were helping. So the Congress and the Aam Aadmi feel that this is a witch hunt, whereas the Bharatiya Janata Party feels that this is nothing but due process. I would like to welcome all our guests this evening. We have Dr. Ajay Kumar of the Congress Party. We have Mr. Vijay Jolly of the BJP. Virag Gupta, who's a petitioner, who's the lawyer in the Delhi High Court for the petitioner in this particular case. And we also have Raghav Chadda, MLA and spokesperson of the Aam Aadmi Party. Thank you all of you all. Raghav, I want to begin with you first. Dilip Pandey of the Aam Aadmi Party was also questioned. There was an inquiry that happened. Why do you feel that this is a witch hunt? Because, you know, the Bharatiya Janata Party has said that they're only following court orders, that this is a process of law, and many of their own leaders have also been questioned.
Look, first of all, as far as the plain reading of the order of the High Court is concerned, High Court has not directed the Delhi police to conduct any such investigation. They have merely said that we are not inclined to ask the CBI to step in and inquire. And if the petitioner feels that there is a valid grievance, he can approach the appropriate forum, which in this case happens to be the Commissioner of Police. The court has not directed any investigation per se to be conducted, number one. So therefore, this is a lame duck excuse by the BJP to cover its own misdeeds. Now, what is this crime? I really wish to understand, what is the crime in this? Is helping people now become a crime? Is providing oxygen to those who are gasping for breath or facilitating the purchase of medicines has now for a person who needs this life-saving drug has become a crime? And if it is a crime, I urge the Delhi police to register cases against all of us, number one. Number two, also record statements of the relatives and attendants of these patients whose lives were saved by supplying of this oxygen and facilitating of these medicines.
Okay.
Number three, it appears that the motto of this government is na seva karunga, na karne dunga.
Okay.
And in this hour of crisis, Sanket, the biggest humanitarian crisis that one has seen in mankind, the biggest crime is to sit back, watch people die and not do anything.
Okay, I'm going to come back to you, Raghav. Let me quickly give all the guests their time for opening comments. Mr. Vijay Jolly, I'm going to start the counter for 1 minute for your opening comments. You've heard what Raghav Chadda had to say. Your response.
You see, Aam Aadmi Party has an old history, hitting and running away. They have not done the needful in the capital, and this is the bare fact with the Prime Minister giving them funds in December 2020 for building 8 oxygen production plants. What is their score on that? Only one. Where are the balance 7? Another thing, is it not true that Navneet Karla, who has been accused of hoarding and black marketing of oxygen concentrators, was one of the 50 guests at the last swearing-in ceremony of the Honorable Chief Minister, Arvind Kejriwal, and of course Raghav was also present over there. Is it not a true fact? And this is also a fact that Navneet did not have a license to peddle into all those things for which the police has accused. And number three, BJP has never raised the bogey of the victim card. If the Aam Aadmi Party MLAs are being interrogated, so are the BJP leaders. Also, Mr. Gautam Gambhir and Mr. Harish Khurana.
Harish Khurana. Okay, I'm going to come back to you in just a short moment. Mr. Virag Gupta, you're the lawyer for the petitioner. Your opening comments.
This petition is reflecting how state is failed. Secondly, how the leaders with the their hold in the government are taking advantage and becoming above law. Only question is they should be allowed to do all type of services. But those drugs which are regulated, which cannot be stored, either procurement or storage or distribution, all is illegal. So there is an All India network and all the parties are involved, either BJP, Congress, Aam Aadmi Party, Shiv Sena.
We seem to have lost that connection, Mr. Gupta. We'll come back to you, Mr. Virag Gupta. We lost that connection. Ajoy Kumar, Dr. Kumar, your opening comments.
Look, I think the only crime which is right now, which Delhi police should investigate, is the missing Prime Minister and the Home Minister and the missing 303 BJP MPs and all their MLAs and a missing government. There is a leading national magazine which said this is missing and people should file a complaint. And that is what is actually seen on the ground. So obviously when the government is missing, when the government is doing nothing, government is absolutely being vindictive and going after people, then the space is filled up by good citizens, whether it's irrespective of whether it's Srinivas from the Congress, whether it is Dilip Pandey from the Aam Aadmi Party or from some people from the BJP. Now, look at this fascist mindset. In UP, they filed an FIR against a boy who was requesting for oxygen for his grandfather. Your property will be seized by the UP Chief Minister's order if you complain that there is no oxygen. Dead bodies are floating across the Ganges, but that is not an issue. And no FIR.
Okay, so you're saying that all of this is nothing but an extension of all those actions. I'm going to come back to you in just a short moment. But, you know, Mr. Jolly, Vikram Singh, former DGP of Uttar Pradesh, is also with us. Thank you very much, sir. I'm going to come back to you in just one moment. Mr. Jolly, the point is, through the course of this afternoon, ever since we saw the pictures of the police at the Indian Youth Congress office inquiring, at that moment, the Bharatiya Janata Party kept saying that this is a court order. The police is acting because the court has asked them to. Now, I want to read out a news report from the 4th of May of what exactly the Delhi High Court said. They said, in relation to instances falling within the jurisdiction of this court, we direct the petitioner to place his grievances before the Commissioner of Police of the Delhi Police, who shall examine the same and respond to the petitioner. The court has not asked for this probe. The court has asked the petitioner to go to the police so that a probe may happen. They've just stated the law. Do you think that this is slightly incorrect on the part of the BJP to call this a court-ordered probe?
You see, whatever happens in the country, you accuse the BJP unfairly, you target the BJP unfairly. If a petitioner goes to the court and expresses his strong opinion that the Aap Aadmi MLA and Minister Imran Khan has been accused of holding the cylinders, and the court says, directs the police, conduct an impartial inquiry, report back the inquiry report to us. Where is the BJP involved? Yes. Let the police conduct the impartial inquiry. That inquiry has been conducted in Imran Khan's case. That has been conducted in the case of Navneet Karla, who is the right-hand man of the ruling party in the capital, Aam Aadmi Party. That has been conducted in the case of the BJP MP, Mr. Gautam Gambhir, against whom allegations were brought in by the Delhi government
by that logic, Mr. Jolly, tell me something.
Harish Khurana. So where is the BJP
Mr. Jolly,
coming
one
in?
Of the things it is that the law of the land. Said.
It is the police acting, and you all make it as if this is a crisis of confidence. This is a crisis of police acting beyond their barriers and boundaries. It is absolutely incorrect, sir.
Okay, Mr. Jolly, one of the things that the petitioner, Mr. Virag Gupta, we were speaking in an earlier broadcast where you said that the problem is that drugs that are supposed to be at a chemist store are landing with politicians. And they should only be given with prescription. How are under prescription Schedule H drugs with politicians? Is that correct?
Sanket, please allow me to read the complete order, relevant portion of the Delhi High Court order.
Relevant portion, because for complete
yes,
we won't have that.
No, it says, in case the alleged incidents are found to have taken place in Delhi, the Delhi police should take appropriate steps by registration of FIR. The petitioner should imprint Delhi police. Then it further says, the status report has to be filed in relation to the alleged incident committed within the jurisdiction of the court within a week.
May I?
Now, on 4th May, this order was passed. Delhi police was directed to file the status report. For filing the status report, we have given the two lists. One list we have given of the leaders in Delhi. Other list we have given the All India list, wherein Shiv Sena, NCP, BJP, all leaders are there.
Correct.
So in other list we have said, please register the zero FIR. And in Delhi we have said that please investigate and register the FIR. Now they are saying, why you have not issued the notice? For the preliminary inquiry, no notice is required to be issued.
No, Mr. Gupta, you know the larger point of your petition. See, if we get too much into this, we'll miss the larger point. I'll come to you, Mr. Chadha. The larger point that you were making was how do politicians, using their clout, procure drugs that are otherwise supposed to be given out only with prescription?
No, one more point is there.
Yeah.
These drugs are being distributed from the offices of political parties' leaders. In Gujarat, their BJP president is distributing. In Maharashtra, ex-chief minister, earlier chief minister was involved in all these things. Mm. One Shiv Sena MP, one BJP MP, they were having the charter flight from Delhi to Bombay. And what happened? Aam Aadmi Party and Congress both have accused BJP. And BJP and Congress have accused the Aam Aadmi Party. Now when allegations are there, they don't want police to investigate. Common persons, millions of the persons are penalized. They are being sent to the jail without any investigation. But when it comes to the political leaders, they want to become above law.
Okay, I think one of the points that is being made, Raghav Chadha, here is that you carry out a probe against everyone. Like, for instance, there have been various cases, even in Delhi, the East Delhi MP, Mr. Gautam Gambhir, had a stock of Fabiflu in his office, which he was distributing. He did it as a sense of duty. But the point is that I think the question that is being raised is that is a drug which is ideally supposed to be at a chemist shop, not in a party office. Yeah.
Look, Sanket, I don't speak for Gautam Gambhir, and I pray to God a day never comes when one will have to speak for Gautam Gambhir. He may put out his own defense. Yeah. I only speak for my party, and I can certainly say that my party colleague, Dilip Pandey, and from what I've learned from social media, Srinivas of the Congress party as well, has only been facilitating purchase of medicines from a particular or several authorized distributors. It's essentially connecting the attendant of the patient with a verified lead who has the license to sell that drug. That does not cause any prejudice to anybody who is in urgent need of that particular drug, because it is a legit transaction between a patient and the person selling the drug. It is only facilitating that trade, number one. Number two, for any crime to be proven, there is something called as mens rea, that is a guilty mind. That is that there should be malafides. Do you think Srinivas of Congress or Dilip Pandey of Aam Aadmi Party or several other leaders, perhaps even in the BJP, are doing this with malafides? Is this not a case of mere bona fides? Number one. Number two, you cannot do selective reading of the High Court order. The portion of the High Court order that you read, Sanket, was most relevant, where the High Court said that you approach the police commissioner's office and see if he wishes to conduct an inquiry. And if in his inquiry, in case there is any merit in the inquiry, in case there is any merit in the allegation, then you proceed against those people. So you cannot do a selective reading. And secondly, let me say this in conclusion, Sanket, that Gurdwaras, NGOs, all these organizations are supplying oxygen, facilitating trade of medicines, finding oxygen beds for people. Are all these guilty of these crimes? Is this what we have come down to? And Dilip Pandey of my party has the backing of the Aam Aadmi Party. Srinivas has backing of the Congress. Gautam Gambhir may have the backing of BJP. Imagine hundreds and thousands of those who do not have the backing of a political party and are doing this purely on humanitarian grounds. They will be deterred. They will be scared to facilitate medicines for a person. They will feel as if they will tomorrow be held by a court of law or by the Delhi police.
Okay, okay.
This is not a question of one particular individual.
Okay, it's not a question of one individual. Mr. PKD Nambiar is also with us, but very quickly, DGP Vikram Singh. You know, how do you look at the police's action as of this moment? Do you feel that this was too keen to investigate one and let the other person off? I think another point that was being made by many people in the Congress is that ideally in a situation like this, you first serve a notice. You don't just land up on the door, Mr. Singh.
Sanket ji, as if the pandemic was not enough, we have seen hoarding of essential drugs and material assuming epidemic proportions. The job of the police is very simple. It is not a matter of choice to investigate everyone fairly, irrespective of what political affiliation that person has. And as Shakespeare had said, the quality of charity droppeth down like gentle rain. It is not only for your supporters or your followers only. As Mr. Raghav Chadha has said, mens rea may or may not be there, but ignorance of law is also cannot be an excuse. And there was a saying in WhatsApp, agar aapko apni aukaat pata lagani hai, to ek bed oxygen ka ek cylinder ram.
Okay, we seem to have lost that connection. We come back to you, Mr. Singh, so that you can complete your point. But
okay.
Mr. Singh is back, I'm being told. Yes, Mr. Singh.
Yes. And the fact of the matter is that if hoarding is there, Remdesivir being sold for 1 lakh, oxygen cylinders in acute proportions, but if robbing the Peter to pay the Paul cannot be justified by any logic or even common sense. The police have a job, and my advice to the police, I must compliment Mr. Virag Gupta, that should be unsparing irrespective of who's in the ruling party, who's in the opposition, who is high and who's mighty.
Okay.
And those prescription drugs that have been given off the shelf to supporters and followers cannot be condoned as ignorance of law or mens rea.
No, I think, what is the point that we are trying to make here? Dr. Kumar, I want to come to you now. What is the main point? Are political parties hoarding medicines? Are they involved in black marketing?
The question is very simple. Remdesivir and oxygen, those are the main items, obviously ambulances and hearse vans, but those are two main items which has caused a huge amount of distress across the country. Both are controlled by the government of India. So the FIR should have been against his government, Mr. Modi and his government, because Remdesivir's production was stopped in January. You didn't even take the drugs lying with the exporters of Remdesivir, Indian pharma companies. You didn't even give the order to sell it back in India. You didn't approve that till April. I don't know if you have done it till now. So you made sure there is a shortage of Remdesivir. You made sure that the oxygen order of 2,000 tons of order, Mr. Modi was so busy with the election that he forgot to sign the paper and signed it on April 19th. So the question again is, forget everything else. The whole humanitarian response on Remdesivir and oxygen, two main people which Delhi police and the petitioner is talking about, I would have been glad if the petitioner would have filed against Mr. Modi and the government asking, why did this happen? Why is there a shortage of oxygen and the ball is in BJP's court and the Prime Minister and the Government of India? Because
okay, let me quickly get in the petitioner as well as Mr. Vijay Jolly so that they can respond. The petitioner first. Mr. Gupta, would you like to respond?
No. 2 seconds.
I am not the petitioner. I am advocate for the petitioner.
Advocate for the petitioner. Yes.
Just no, there are three points. Number one point is what the Congress spokesperson is saying.
Okay, let Dr. Kumar complete. Yes, Dr. Kumar.
Please, I'll just finish, Gupta sir. I'm just saying, Remdesivir is not such a difficult drug. We were exporting. Now, Bangladesh makes Remdesivir. Government of India has got 450,000 vials now, and they're not distributing it. So the whole reason for people dying and good humanitarians, like whether
it is the lack of availability. Okay, I get the point that you're making. Government. So there should be a petition against the government. Mr. Virag Gupta,
absolutely.
How do you respond? And then Mr. Vijay Jolly.
No.
Mr. Gupta and Mr. Jolly.
Sanket, there can be thousands of the petition for failure of the state. So nobody is disputing. Let us restrict only in this petition. Number one, Congress and Aam Aadmi Party on papers and including BJP have accused each other for black marketing. They all have. This is in record. This has been given to the police. So they can't say that police should not come in the picture. If anybody is doing unlawful activities, then they must surrender before the authority of law. Number one. Number two, police, if they have to investigate, as per the CRPC, they will go, they will investigate the matter, they will file the report. So they have done within that jurisdiction. Number three, if Aam Aadmi Party is talking of the new way of the this politics or the governance or whatsoever may be, then they must address two issues which are there in this petition. Number one, there is a diminishing difference between the government and the political parties. Now, from the government sources, you are procuring the drugs and other things, and you are distributing from your offices and from the MLAs, MPs. This thing is very disturbing.
No, is that an allegation?
Secondly,
do you have proof to back up this claim?
I'll respond to this.
Yes. There is a proof against the BJP Gujarat president, against the BJP MP, and against Gautam Gambhir and so many other leaders as per the news report. Whether it is 5 drugs or 5,000 drugs, and if they are not guilty,
using
then they
government
must
machinery
them.
and then showing it as charity.
Yes.
In the name of the
party.
Okay, that's the allegation.
Now the second.
Yeah.
Now one more point. One more point is there. There are lakhs, again, there is police action in during lockdown against lakhs of the person, including in the Congress-ruled states, where there is no inquiry, no investigation.
Okay.
Directly, jurmana is imposed, including in Aam Aadmi Party Delhi. You are traveling alone. When the police comes to them, they say that I am above law. But they are not above law. They are the
okay.
common person.
Mr. Nambiar, would you like to come in here? Many BJP leaders who are using, according to Mr. Gupta, who are using their position in governments to then, you know, basically get in the vaccines, get in medicines, get in oxygen, and then project it as charity.
See, there are we are a large country, there are different leaders. I would not say that everybody is a good leader, whether it is in Aam Aadmi Party or Congress or in BJP. There may be some foul place, there are some people who may be doing wrong. Something like which we heard in Delhi, one of the MLA was carrying so much of an oxygen. But in the meantime, it is also important to know that they are public representatives. They also have some kind of a commitment to the people, irrespective of any political party. So if they are doing some good, because I know a large number of NGOs and individuals who are doing extremely superb job on the ground, wherever there is a government is failing. I think sometimes such kind of a PIL activism, I would not call it like it is always for a good cause, it is also for a PIL activism. PIL activism is also a reality in this country only for a PR purpose. I am not saying that the crime branch...
No, are you calling this PIL and the subsequent investigation a PR stunt?
I'll tell you one thing. In the morning, I don't know whether you have seen that interview or the speech of the Congress spokesperson, Mr. Surjewala. He was accusing left, right, center to the Prime Minister, to the Amit Shah, to everybody in the Union Cabinet, saying that it is all driven by the BJP netas and the BJP's police is reaching everywhere. Even in the later part of the day, we all realized it was nothing to do with the BJP or the government, but it is all coming because of a PIL and a court order. The problem in this country today is that even if it is some good people wanted to do good thing,
Sanket,
they won't let it happen.
Oh, I think this is a strange point where Mr. PKT Nambiar is defending the entire political fraternity, and Mr. Gupta, you are the villain today.
I am saying that why
Mr. Gupta, who is indulging in PIL activism.
Please allow me to explain.
Yeah.
Petitioner Dr. Deepak Singh, it is his first petition. He is son of former Air Force officer, and he is a national shooter. He was disturbed because there is a police danda against the common people. But these leaders, who as a government failed, the state has failed, central government has failed, the state government, all the state governments failed, and instead of accepting the failure, instead of working on the governance, they are trying to become the stars.
Vikram Singh wants to come in, and then Raghav Chadda. Yes.
If they have not done anything wrong, why they are afraid of police?
Just one sentence. Mr. Deepak Singh and Mr. Veera Gupta have nothing to gain or lose in this as our political friends. They have nothing to gain or lose. It is only as an honest Indian that they want to prove a point and let him cast the first stone who has not sinned before. My advice to political analysts and politician friends would be this.
Okay. Mr. Vijay Jolly and then Raghav Chadda.
Sanket.
You see, I would wish to thank the Delhi Chief Minister for his statement on NDTV 13th April 2021. Sir, please note that there is no shortage in the capital of oxygen and beds. Subsequently, on 18th of April, he starts harping on the shortages. And then his own MLAs, his own ministers start holding oxygen concentrators and cylinders. And there is a certain big surge of shortages in the capital. Please allow me to speak.
Oh, lots of conspiracy theories today.
Can you back this up with proof? Yes, I have the proof. You revived your TV channels.
No,
and
I know
you
that
were
interview.
There along with the
we
chief
only
minister.
Did that interview.
Don't
I know.
Ask me a proof. I will on the next show. I challenge you that I will prove it
Sanket,
along with
can
the
I just
documentary
speak? Can
and video evidence. So let me complete it, Mr. Sanket. Number two, this petition which came in the court. And the court said, you go over to the relevant authorities, which is the Delhi Police Commissioner. And the Delhi Police Commissioner start investigating. Why is the victim card being played by the Aam Aadmi Party, by the Congress
General,
Party?
Okay, Raghav Chadda, your General, response.
Now you have to.
Very quickly, yes.
Okay, just give me some time. There are four people who are speaking against the motion and only two of us in favor of it. Just give me some time. Look, first of all, it was your channel that broadcasted the news first. That the Delhi High Court has quashed the case filed against my colleague Imran Hussain, one of our ministers in the government, where the allegation was that he's hoarded some oxygen cylinders. The High Court quashed that and said that he's doing excellent service, exemplary service for the people of his constituency. There is no hoarding and he's saving lives. Number one, that is what the High Court said. So all of us should get our facts right before we make these absolutely frivolous, malicious allegations. That's number one. Number two, I do agree with the lawyer on the panel, and we must. I do agree with the lawyer on the panel, and we must not. Look, let me finish. Let me finish.
One by one, please. I have very limited time.
Let's have a sensible debate. Calm down.
How can you have a double standard by a
I was never over speaking when you were speaking. Please understand now, Sanket. You need to put his fader down. He won't stop. These people never stop.
Nobody's fader goes down. Yeah.
Please understand. Yes, Ankit, you cannot.
One moment, Mr. Nambiar, let him complete.
There are two sets of people. There are two sets of people. First is, of course, the likes of Navneet Kalra and others, and the police must proceed against them. There is no reason why the police should not proceed against them. The second is the case of bona fide service done by the likes of Srinivas and Dilip Pandey.
Yeah.
Proceeding against them is disgraceful and shows how the police's own intentions are malafide. And
okay.
When I say police is a mere puppet. Those who are the political masters of the police. Okay. And lastly, Sanket, if there is a crime in this humanitarian crisis, it is the following. Number one, exporting vaccines, 6.5 crore vaccines when the country needs it. Number two, exporting 13,000 metric ton of oxygen. Number three, buying non-functional ventilators using PM Care funds and
okay,
sending it
so
to
states.
Okay,
so this is going to go on.
And
I'm,
number four.
Okay,
I'm running out of time. We're going to continue this discussion later. The point is, we're deeply divided politically as far as our response to COVID-19 is concerned. Exhibit right in front of you. Thank you very much. Good night and goodbye.